question is how do we respond? You know, I can wait, but while I'm waiting and do nothing, and I feel like basically I'm preparing to fail when the opportunities arrive post COVID-19. For me, this is life. Because if we think about it, you know, when my pandemic happened, when my mother died, I could have committed suicide. But then looking at it now, actually, I could have died when my mother died and continue to exist.
Well, greetings again. I mentioned in my last installment of this Tough Minds, Tender Hearts and Steady Hands series that my next respondent was someone exceptional, even by the standards set by the 5-6 people that I've had so far, and I think they would agree. Well, if you were to ask me for an example of somebody who really showed evidence of a tough mind, how about this? A 15-year-old who scores 100% for his mathematics and 98% for his physical science in his final grade 12 matric exams, who then goes on to becoming the very first black South African to get his PhD in the enormously complex discipline of geophysics. And a tender heart? Well, how about somebody who in his final exams travelled some 600 kilometres from Johannesburg to his home in the rural KwaZulu-Natal village of Ndwedwe every weekend to care for his sick mother, and who has now established a foundation to promote the teaching of maths and science among disadvantaged learners in under-resourced schools, who also then spends his weekends packing and distributing food parcels to needy students in the inner city. Now, I'm talking about Professor Musa Manzi. He also scores on that third criterion of a wise man, the steady hands, because he is a founder director of the Seismology Research Center at Wits University to research how to avoid earthquakes underground that put the lives of mine workers at risk from rock bursts and methane gas explosions. Now, in the last episode, we talked about synchronicities. Well, as I was preparing for this interview, I checked in his Facebook post. And there was a recent post on Facebook where Musa congratulates one of his recent PhD graduates. And he says, "What a great way to start a weekend with a new research publication from our PhD candidate, Michael Westgate. Well done, Mike, for getting your first PhD paper published." And then Michael himself replies and says, "Thanks, Musa, and congrats to you too. Having you as my supervisor has been one of my biggest gratitudes." Well, that figures. Well, I see, of course, Musa himself features as one of the co-authors of that paper, which, of course, I take to mean that Musa has been a steady hand to guide Michael and other students through the process of getting his PhD. Well, rather than do a Zoom interview, Musa said he would prefer I come to his home. So I'm going to do the interview there. As we drive to his home, I will explain some more about the framing of our conversation and the backstory to it. So this is the backstory that I need to tell you, because it's bound to come up in my conversation with Musa. Musa and I became friends about 18 months ago, introduced to me by my friend, Professor Ray Durheim, who supervised Musa's PhD. Because Musa spoke Zulu, I asked him if he had come and help me with the translation of some subtitles I wanted to put in one of my films. He obviously agreed, and he came to my house and sat and talked with me about our stories, but he was far more interested in my story than in telling me his own. But it's thanks to my friend Eusebius McKaiser, who interviewed Musa recently on his radio show, that I actually got to realize what a remarkable person Musa is. Well, 3 weeks ago I was lying in hospital recovering from having had some maintenance to my heart to toughen it up with another stent to extend my shelf life,
And I was lying in the recovery unit in the ICU and paging through my Facebook posts, and there was one from Eusebius McKaiser, absolutely raving about the interview he had just had with Musa Manzi. But there was a story about my friendship with Musa, which of course Eusebius wouldn't have known, and which explains how Musa and I actually bonded. And it was a story I was bursting to share, because when I met Musa, I had just got back from having interviewed my Uncle Michael in Durban as part of my research into my own family narrative. Now, Michael was the last of 11 children that my grandparents on my mother's side had. He had been diagnosed with terminal cancer. And I grabbed my camera, jumped in my car and drove to Durban because I wanted to interview him again to find out what else I needed to know from the last of a generation so that I could hand it down to my cousins and their offspring. I've got quite a tribe of them, as you can imagine. But I was also doing it to practice what I preach, or at least what Brené Brown and Ben Okri preach, about the necessity of owning our history so that we can write our own stories as owned stories. But there was a strange sense of synchronicity in sitting down with Musa, because he told me that his mission in life as a seismologist and geophysicist was to develop scientific understanding so as to reduce the risk of rock bursts and methane gas explosions in deep level mining and save lives. Well, thanks to my Uncle Michael, who sadly died, in fact, exactly a year ago now, and I learned that Grandpa had nearly lost his life on two occasions. Once when a fellow mine worker went crazy and became violent, but I would rather not talk about that one, as there were some casualties. Fortunately, not my grandfather, because if he had perished, well, the population of South Africa would be significantly reduced, having fathered 11 children. But the story which Musa found particularly significant was a good news story. One day, for reasons unknown, Grandpa found himself alone and lost in a maze of tunnels deep underground, separated from his fellow workers. He was completely disoriented, trying to get his bearings.
I mean, he was lost twice.
Really, underground?
Yeah, sure. And one time he lay down eventually and you could see rat's eyes. I remember this so well. He said he could see rat's eyes and that, and there was an inch of water on the ground and he was gone. But he heard this noise of a sort of singing.
Oh.
He jumped up and ran. Didn't know where to go, but just tried to follow the noise. It came across the Zulu.
A singing Zulu mine worker saved the life of my grandfather. Well, Musa asked if he could tell that story to his students because it was for him an allegory of his own mission and purpose in his professional life. To save lives of underground mine workers by the use of sound. And Musa happens to also be a very accomplished singer. So I said, of course he could, so long as he put it to music and sang it. Well, I think you can now understand why I've just got to hear Musa telling us his life story.
Thanks, John, my friend, for having this conversation with me. It's something I appreciate because I think I have a story to tell and to share, which resonates with a lot of South Africans. So, yeah, I was born in KwaZulu-Natal, raised by a single mother. My dad passed away when I was 2 years old, and he left my mother to raise myself and my six siblings. That was difficult, and my mother was working as a domestic worker. But one of the most difficult moments is when I found out when I was 16 years old that a day before my dad passed away, according to my mom telling me, is that my dad tried to kill me because I wasn't his son. And then later on, he committed suicide because of the major fight between him and my mother. And after hearing that story, I was wrestling with that sense of belonging, you know, not knowing who I am. because before the age of 16, I was thinking, you know, I'm Manzi, you know, because this is my dad. And now I'm hearing the stories that my dad never thought that I was his child. And I remember confronting my mother and say, who is my dad? You know, my mom said, he was your dad.
Musa, in my social group counseling, I find it helpful to help people own their stories by recognizing that there's basically three stages that seem to be universal, which Father Richard Rohr and Franciscan priests has helped me understand, that we move from a state of order through disorder to reorder. There's no non-stop flight from order to reorder. You have to go through the disorder. But it seems to me that you never really knew order in the sense of a stable, predictable and secure home environment.
And if you're talking about the whole disorder, and that's the stage I was at, because I find myself not focusing at school because I didn't know who I was. Eventually, I met a woman who was talking to me, trying to figure out, and she said to me, it doesn't really matter what your surname is. Your surname is not who you are. And that's when I really started figuring out myself, where I belong, who I am, and just to accept myself for who I was. And so also my mother, working as a domestic worker, she was earning about 350 rand, you know, per month to support 7 of us. And of course we had other kids also were staying at home, you know how in the rural areas things are and stuff. And I never wanted to go to school because my mother couldn't afford to pay for school fees. I didn't have school uniform and all that. So I actually hated school because I was also bullied a lot at school. And one of the reasons actually that my dad didn't believe I was his child because I was the darker child in the family. You know, I was skinny and darker than my sisters were all like light in complexion and my mother was light. So I was the only darkest child in the family. So that's one of the reasons he believed that I was not his. And also I was bullied at school quite a lot because I was darker. So I grew up in that environment and hating school. I was so lucky that the teachers, because I think they were fond of me because they thought I was good in maths and in music. I used to sing a lot. And so they would come back and tell my mother to force me to go to school. And so I really struggled to focus on school because I dropped out a couple of times. And then eventually, the teachers came to my home and they had a conversation with my mother and said, this boy has potential. He's like scored 100% for everything that he's done and you must force him to go back to school. So my mother used to shout at me and say, you know, I brought you on this earth, but I'm not responsible for what you become. And my mother, I still remember my mom's shouting, you know, when I was young, go to school, go to school, go to school. Actually, my mother, when I was doing grade 1, they asked my mother to give me an English name. So my mother looked at me and said, this boy, when I'm at home cooking, he likes helping me cutting pieces of meat so that everyone will have equal part. And said, I think he's gonna be a mathematician. And so she wanted me to be a doctor. She named me doctor. So my name is Musa Pure Dr. Manzi. And I started loving school. And it was only in grade 8 that I was actually focusing more on school. So my brothers and sisters dropped out of school. And then they started looking for low-paying jobs as gardeners and domestic workers. So I was left alone in the school. There is a conversation that I had with my teacher when I was doing grade 7, and she said to me, Musa, people can say whatever they say. You can be bullied. They can tell you that you're not from this particular family, but you have a right to believe or not to believe. And said, you are actually responsible for whatever you become. Mm-hmm. And said, you are beautiful the way you are. It doesn't matter how people see you. And to me, that was a turning point of how I looked at myself. Because at the end of the day, as I'm talking to you now, if someone says to me, are you Manzi? I'm like, I'm not sure, because I'm not sure that was my dad. But it doesn't matter anymore, because I know that Manzi is not who I am. Mm-hmm. You see, so the beauty starts the moment I accept myself for who I am. And that's what she told me. And she also mentioned one of the African proverbs that says, if there's no enemy within, the enemy outside will do no harm. So basically it's a matter of, do you believe what people say? And she said to me, they can only define you if you allow them. And so that has been an anchor of my life growing up, that I don't really care what people say.
You know, we're talking about Brené Brown. I mean, her whole research was on shame and vulnerability. Mm. And that was her whole point, that when people are able to own their shame, as difficult as it is, she says, a balance that's always better for people to go into that dark place than not to, and to deny it. So you're an extraordinary example of somebody who not only had to deal with the shame that black people had been projected upon because of growing up in apartheid, but even a double sense of marginalization and exclusion because of your peer group. But yet there was someone in your life that actually could see the potential within you. Say a bit more about that person.
This lady, actually, she was a teacher, left teaching, and she went to become a nurse. She's in the US right now. She's still a good friend of mine, and she's following my progress. And she played a huge role in my life. You know, we went through a lot of chats about who I am and how I was trying to do so much to please people because I wanted to be accepted. Because she first threw a couple of questions. It's like, if you had certain regrets in your life, what would those regrets be? And I said, not knowing who my dad is, being born in a poor family, being raised by a single mother. And she said, those are not disappointments, or they're not your regret. Your regret should be you believing what people say about you. You know, and going to high school, so I went to grade 8. That's when I really started loving school. Then I started loving maths and physical science. And then grade 9, we found out that there were no teachers at school to teach those subjects. So I took it upon myself to teach myself maths, physical science, and biological science with my classmates. And then grade 12, for the first time in that school, I scored 100% for maths, and my classmate also passed maths for the first time in the history of the school. So that's how I got to vets, you know. And
now, let's just pause here, because that was what absolutely floored Eusebius McKaiser. I want people to just, for it to sink in.
Yeah.
You had no teachers in maths and science. You took responsibility for teaching yourself and your fellow classmates. And you got 100% for maths and not yet. I just found that extraordinary, coming from a relatively disadvantaged background. I mean, but say a bit more about what it was about mathematics and science that actually, you know, sort of got the popcorn to pop for you.
It's actually a very good question, because at that time, I mean, I didn't really know what I wanted to do when I finished school. And to be honest, because in my whole area, and of course in my family, no one had ever finished matric. So all I wanted to do was to finish matric and break the barriers and be the only one in my family to finish matric. I didn't have a dream beyond matric. One of the things I liked about math was that, of course, in the rural areas, you know, we're not good with languages. For example, we didn't have a good English teacher, Afrikaans. So I found that mathematics, you could only talk through X and Y's. So it was the easiest subject for me to understand, because biological science, you needed to understand English in depth and probably be able to summarize the story very well. So we're not taught to think that way. So in terms of X and Y, math was just the easiest thing, I think, for me. But so when I started my grade 8, that I knew that at some stage in life, I would love to become a doctor. But I wasn't clued up about careers. You know, when you grow up in the rural areas, you only know about nursing, police, and probably teachers. So those are the careers that you're exposed to. But I wanted to do something bigger at some stage, but I wasn't sure what it was. And also, there was no one in my area was a role model to say, you know, I want to be a medical doctor, I want to be an engineer. We didn't have such in my area. Mm-hmm. So one of the reasons I loved math was when I used to do math, I found out that you actually have to do a lot of things to get into the solution. So for example, there's a lot of laws and theorems and axioms that you have to put together to solve a problem. So I found that my thinking was more aligned with that, not just to produce a solution, but to think of other ways, alternative ways to actually get to the final end. And I remember one of the things that I used to like about math was that it also teaches you like perseverance, you know, because it's not like you can move from A to B. So you fight, you fight, you fight, you fight. And then when you get to the end, you look back, you're like, wow, this is really, really amazing. And I didn't know anything about earth scientists, you know, in terms of there's geophysicists and there's geologists and all those kinds of stuff. I just love math as a subject. And physics is very close to math. So loving math made me love physics as well. So also because you don't deal with the language, you just deal with the variables, and then you actually just you just dwell into that. And so what I remember when I told my principal, and one of the issues was that there were no laboratories for physics at school. She couldn't believe it. I said to her, I will teach math and physics without the laboratories. And we had a conversation. She was like, there are no resources. And she used to say I was a very stubborn child because I told her that, you know, there are no resources, but my spirit is unlimited. I want to give the best shot and teach my classmates. So we had to vote in the class and say, who wants to be taught by this young kid, you know? And seven of my friends, they said, we're going with him. We're going to do maths. So they never had maths in that school. So we went on to do maths in higher grade. And so we taught ourselves from grade 10 till grade 12. And then for the first time in the history of the school, they produced 100% pass rate for maths and physics. So I got 100% for maths and 98% for physics and then 88% for biology. So at the end of the day, I got 7 distinctions, including the English, that I couldn't speak properly.
I mean, now the interesting thing is, just one observation, getting back to Richard Rohr's idea of order.
It seems to me that in the disorder of your young life, you found in mathematics and science the order, the predictability and the coherence that you were needing. And I've never actually thought of counseling people in crisis to go and study mathematics and science. Normally I tell them to go and read Shakespeare and Dostoevsky or T.S. Eliot. But it's occurred to me that it might be a good idea to actually assist them go and learn mathematics.
Yeah.
Is that a fair
way? Exactly, yeah. That's actually true, because we have what we call in physics the displacement and the distance. So the displacement, you move from A to B, it's a straight line. And then the distance is that before you get to B, you start from A, but you take a journey. And the journey is never straight, so you do quite a lot here. Eventually you get to B. But the same with maths, that you've got a problem, but to solve the problem, you don't have one methodology to solve it. And sometimes you've got to put concepts together, and all of them have to hold for you to reach the solution. So which means that if you look at the mathematical problem or equation, it looks very complex and disordered. But the mathematicians know there's a certain order there, because you're not going to get to B having not fulfilled these laws. I applied quite a lot of that in my life, so actually you have to go through a certain journey, you know, before you get to B. And often I say, in that journey, it takes longer, but that's where you get shaped, that's where your character is shaped, so that when you get to B, then you survive. But I often say that it's not that important to get to B, because what is important is to go through this journey, because when you go through this journey, it shapes your character in such a way that even if you don't get to B, you can be anything you want to be in life, because you embarked on the journey.
And could I put it this way? It's also, you know, we always talk about, you know, you need to get out of your comfort zone.
Exactly.
What I hear you saying is that, well, you had some comfort in seeing the elegant coherence of mathematics. And so that, in a sense, gave you confidence to actually experiment and explore and find new challenges.
Exactly.
And rather than take shortcuts.
Exactly.
Is that what you say?
That's exactly what I'm saying. Because, I mean, also remember that growing up, I didn't have much confidence. And to be honest, one of the things I love about math is because I knew I was good in math and I could beat anyone in math at any time. So that's something that's built more confidence in me, that I may not speak very well, I may not compete on some of the competitions or probably in sports, but I knew that if you give me a mathematical problem, it will make me shine, therefore I become very, very special. That's so, right. For example, we had there was a joke when we were growing up saying that ugly guys like us, they used to say that, get grades, and then cute guys get girls. So I used to say, I'd rather get grades than get girls then. You know, so we used to laugh about it, but that's because it's something that made me shine, that if I couldn't find a girl, therefore beat everyone in math. It gave me some kind of relevance, you know. Then I capitalized more on that than on the things that I was not good at.
Except that, just to say to the girls out there, he's a bachelor, but I'm afraid he's outdated. So you have made yourself a very eligible bachelor by actually going this path. At the same time, you didn't have it easy, even when you actually had got these distinctions. And it seemed to me, I was trying to understand why you decided to go to Wits rather than to Natal University. You went out of your comfort zone again to Wits. And tell us a bit about that experience.
I mean, looking back now, to be honest with you, I think it was probably the most stupid decision I ever made. Because, so the result, grade 12 result, we're out. It's on the news. I think it was on NCA or whatever. We didn't have a television at home, so I didn't know about that. And then the principal drove to where I was staying to say, you're on the news, you got 100% for maths. She drove me to my mother, and my mother, for the first time, you know, she gave me a hug for the first time ever, and she was in tears because she saw the son that she had worked for, hard for. I'm passing matric with flying colors. And then so my mother asked me, so what's next? I was like, I don't know. That day, I got calls from UKZN, University of Zululand, Umbo University, and then Durban was Vivia. So they gave me calls and all offering me positions like engineering and some were even offering to buy me clothes to attract me to their universities. But Wits did not call me. And I told my mom, I said, I had this Wits University. It's in Johannesburg and it's a top university in Africa. I want to go there. I want to go to the top university. And then the following day, I went to my mom and said, I need to go to Johannesburg. I had never been out of the province in my life. And my mother said, do you know where this Johannesburg is? I was like, I will ask when I get there. And I said, all I need from you, I need money for the bus to Johannesburg. And my mother only had 100 rand. And she said to me, I will give you 95 rand. I will keep the 5 rand so that I can call you when you are going to check where you are. So I took a taxi to Durban station. It was the last bus. In the evening, I got to Johannesburg the following day. And I was wandering at Park Station looking for Wits. And then I got to Wits at about 3:30 in the afternoon, when they were just about to close at the enrollment center. And I got there and this man is like to me, so what are you doing? I'm like, I'm here to study. And said, okay, give me your application number. I was like, I didn't apply. I didn't know I had to apply. And I have my clothes and bags here, so I'd have no place to go. And so he said to me, I'm sorry, I can't help you. You know what happened? Inside the enrollment center, there was an Indian man. He spoke to this guy, said, call that boy to come back here, because I was already giving up and leaving. And he said, call him. And then this guy called me, and I went back to the enrollment center. And he said, let him in. I walked in there, and he sat on the phone. He called Verulam. It turned out that this man was my mom's boss friend.
From Verulam.
Yeah. And then he said, I saw this guy on the news, and he said, come inside. So he helped me with application. So while they were doing the application, where's your ID book? I said, I don't have an ID book. And then so they had to call Pretoria for me to apply for an ID book on the same day and receive it on the same day. So because I had six distinctions, so I got 6,000 rand. At that time, they would give you 1,000 rand per distinction. So then I got registered. So that's how I got to VET. Mm. The first 2 years of my academic life at VET, undergraduate, I was sleeping in the library because I didn't have money for accommodation. And again, I don't know why I went through that process, because I could have just dropped out and go to another university where I could get a bursary. At that time, I used to lie to my mom and say that no, I was staying in a nice place and everything was sorted, because I didn't want to trouble her. I didn't want her to worry about me.
And you admit you're doing well, but then the disorder tragedy strikes in your life. You get the news that your mother's died. So suddenly you're thrown into disorder again.
I told her that my mother was so proud of me when I made it to VET. I had so many dreams. One of them was I wanted to build my mother a house because she worked so hard. My mother didn't even know how to write her name. She couldn't sign. She had never been to school herself. You know, she had worked as a domestic worker all her life. And she gave everything she had for me to succeed, you know. And so one, I had bigger dreams. I had a list. I remember in my 3rd year, I was like, I want to get my mother medical aid. I want to build a house. I want to do this, I want to do this, I want to do this. October, in that year, my final year, just before exams, my mother started getting ill. My brothers and sisters were all despairs now because, you know, everyone was trying to find life. So I was at the university. So I started visiting home every Friday to check my mother. There was this particular Friday when I could see that it was 2 weeks away from my 3rd year final exams. I forced my mother to go to the hospital so that I would leave her there and focus on my studies. So we got the ambulance, we took my mother to the hospital, and the nurses said to me there were no available beds for mom to sleep there. I stayed the whole night with my mother on my lap, the whole Friday. It was so cold, waiting for an opportunity or a space so that I could keep my mother in the hospital and come back to Johannesburg. I only had 10 rand in my pocket, which I got from a friend at VET. And the following morning, my mother was crying on my lap, saying that you should have left me at home to die. But I'll never forget that moment, because the following morning, a nurse came to me and said, Musa, we have one bed available. Your mother can stay here, then you can go back and focus on your studies. I had to take my mother to the bathroom first. I washed my mother. The same mother who gave birth to me, I remember that moment. I took her clothes off, I washed her because she couldn't even move. I fed her some chips, which I bought with my last 10 rand. So before I pushed my mother into the ward, I wanted to go inside the ward and check the bed. As I walked in, there was a young lady sleeping at the corner there, next to where my mother was going to be placed. And she said to me, oh, how, Musa, what brings you here in Zulu? Musa was always on my spending. And it turned out that was my sister. Wow. So we didn't know she was sick, but my nieces were staying with my mother at home. And I had not spoken to my sister for like months. Bear in mind that my sister did not know that I was bringing my mother to the hospital. And coincidentally, the bed that was prepared for my mother was next to my sister. Wow. And my mom did not know that my sister was in the hospital. I said to my sister, I'm bringing my mom. She's outside. And I brought my mother. I left both of them in the hospital because I had to go back to VET and prepare for my exams. Following Friday, again, I had to go back to Durban to check on how they were doing at the hospital. And then while I was in the text, a nurse gave me a call saying that they've been discharged, both of them. So I didn't go to the hospital, I went straight home. My sister was sleeping on the floor because we only had one bed. My mother was on the bed, my sister was on the floor. They were still ill. And then I turned to my mother, and my mother said, if I do die, just promise me one thing, that you will always choose to do the right thing, even if doing the right thing is the most difficult thing that you're facing. And that was And I was like, why are you saying these words? You're not dying. And it's like, no, I'm saying you just have to promise me that you will always do the right thing in life, even if doing that right thing is the most difficult thing you have to do. You have to promise me that you'll make that decision. I said, Mom, I'll always do the right thing, even if doing the right thing at that moment is the most difficult thing to do. Overwhelmed, my sister said one word to me. If I die, please look after my kids. I took a walk outside. I came back. My sister was gone. My mother was pretty strong because then she said to me, Musa, please don't worry much and this, and your sister has been ill for some time. I didn't want to tell you. So remember, it's a Friday. I need to go back and prepare for my exam. So I have a week now. Saturday came. I'm going back to Johannesburg. So what we did is we took my sister to the mortuary. The funeral was going to be the next Saturday. I took a taxi in the morning on Saturday. I get to Johannesburg on Saturday evening. Sunday, and I'm preparing all my notes, and I was staying at rest. And then the phone rang. I just ignored it, you know. I want to study. I don't want to focus on this. And the phone rang again, and then I took the phone up. My brother, the moment you left, Mom passed away. And to be honest with you, that was the turning point of my life as a person. You know, if you talk to me today, that was a defining moment because I knew that it was over, you know, in my mind. And I closed my room and I wanted to commit suicide. And in the residence, I don't know what happened, I can't remember even now, but there were policemen and I tried to jump over the window, and the policeman came on the other side and I was rescued. I went to the hospital, and then the students, amazing, they came to the hospital to support me, and all of them took the bus with me to Devon to go see my mother, who was lying, was still lying on the floor when I got home. She was taken to the mortuary, and then I stayed at home, and on Saturday, the following Saturday, we had a funeral for both of them in one day. And I was, of course, I missed my exams, I missed everything. Then I was taken back to Johannesburg by a friend, and I was ill. I can't remember what happened, but I spent about the whole of November and a bit of December in Johannesburg Hospital. I was discharged in late December. And then I went back to vet. I was sleeping in the offices because I had no place to go. Exams were over. I didn't want to go back home because I had no mom. I had nobody. I still had that piece of paper. I had written a few words that there was nothing left for me to live for. And I still don't know how I did not commit suicide at that stage. January came. Remember now, I had missed exams. I had not written any exams. So basically, I was back in the streets trying to figure out what to do. The school opened. I went straight to the dean at Vert University that I missed my exam because my mom was sick. All the psychologists I had seen, they had written the letters to the university not to allow me back because I was not stable mentally. I was not ready to face an academic year. By a miracle, I was allowed to write all my exams in February. All six of them. I passed five. I failed one, which was chemistry. I got 45%. I think they pushed me. And then I could proceed to my honors year. The question was, I didn't have a place to stay. That's when a friend of mine who was in the class and said, you're not smelling good. Where do you sleep? You know. And then she said to me, can I invite you for dinner at my mom's house? And I said, for sure. And then so we went to Notcliffe, and then I met her parents, and her mother gave me a kiss for the first time. And she said, you're such a beautiful boy. And bear in mind that in my mind, I've always thought I was an ugly child. And this woman comes to me and gives me a kiss. You know white people like kissing. And so she gave me a kiss. And when I walked into that house, there was a big dog in the house. And So we had dinner, and then after dinner they said, do you have a place to stay? And I said, yeah, I have a place to stay. I was lying. And this woman, her mother said, okay, from now onwards, you're going to stay with us. You're not going anywhere. You're going to sleep on the couch here. We don't have an extra room, so you're going to sleep on the couch. So that's how I got into honors in geophysics. And then after that, this woman realized that I was not well. And I said to her, I can't focus on my studies. I need to figure out where my nieces are. Mm-hmm. A phone rang, got a call that my brother was killed. Went back to Durban, buried my brother. On the way back to Johannesburg, I said, I'm going with you to my nieces. And everyone was like, where are you taking them to? I said, I'm going to Johannesburg. I didn't go back to my friend's family because I didn't want to bother them with my nieces. So we stayed at Vert in the library. So I did all my honors staying in the library with the kids. You know, in one night we slept at Park Station. There we were, because now I was doing my honors, so I was using an honors room as a place to sleep. You know, I was washing them in the basin. They had no school, so I was staying with them, three of us. Of course, we were called into accommodation officer and a disciplinary hearing at Vets, and people were finding out what was going on. But I can tell you now that I had so much support from them. And then I passed my honors with staying with them, and then masters, the same family discovered that actually I was staying at Vert with the kids, and they invited us back at home and they said, please come back, you can stay with us with the kids. And they paid for them at the school. They continued to pay for my masters. And then when I finished my masters, they were so excited because they thought, finally, you're going to have a job and work. And I told them, said, I want to do my PhD. Mm-hmm. And they said, don't you want to work and make money and support these kids? And I said, when I took these kids, I knew that I didn't want to sacrifice my career, but at the same time, I wanted to help them. And I said, I want to achieve my goals while helping them, because it doesn't do any good to them or to myself to take a low-paying job so that I can support them. And she looked at me and said, you're crazy. And I said, Mom, I'm starting a PhD. So I did my PhD, and then, of course, I became the first Black South African to obtain a PhD in geophysics.
I mean, it just leaves me gobsmacked. I just think, you know, I almost don't want to say anything.
Yeah.
Because it just speaks for itself, you know, from your experience. But I want to just talk a bit now about your professional career now, because that's really where you and I found a connection. And when we met, when you came to my home to help me, I had no idea about that history, but you and I connected and we shared a bit of each other's stories. And I want to share this because it illustrates for other people the impact that you've had on people's lives and on my life, because I was telling you about my history, about my my grandfather.
I mean, the one thing I liked about your story was when you, of course, spoke about, you know, the singing. I'm a musician. Oh, I love singing, to put it. And if we talk about singing, we talk about sounds. And in my profession, we use sound waves to investigate the subsurface of the earth to search for minerals. And I mean, one of the songs we sing when we go to the mines, like Shosholoza. And sometimes, you know, when you walk in the tunnel there, it's so dark, so you can't see each other, you just follow the voice, you know? And to me, that story resonated with me, and also how actually in the old days, and just a simple thing like singing could save someone's life. And that's actually where my research is, that we're trying to mitigate the risk that's associated with rock burst in the mines, rock falls, and of course the mine seismicity, which is earthquakes. And one of the things is that when you're underground, the rocks will talk, like will make a sound. And they often say, if it's too quiet, it's too dangerous. Really? And if there's a lot of noise from the rocks, it's also too dangerous. So basically, you never know which is the right condition to actually have in the mines underground. and identify areas that might be prone to mine seismicity. Don't mine there, or be cautious when you mine in those areas. So one of the things we try to do is basically develop innovative and environmentally friendly technologies to mine. For the first paper in my PhD, which actually got the best paper award in geophysics in 2012, which was my first scientific paper ever, it was to identify how methane gas get transported in a mining level, because there's been a lot of incidents in terms of methane explosion and then mines get killed. But nobody knows how the methane get into the mining level in the first place. So my research was, I really want to discover more ore, but I want to save the miners. So I came up with this algorithm to analyze the seismic data to say, actually, we can identify the methane pathways, which means that these are the fault lines that are connected underground. So they transmit water and methane to a stop, because you've got air there, and all you need is a bit of oxygen, and then you're going to have explosion. So that's exactly what I did. So basically, I developed this model to say in the mines, we can, ahead of mining, identify the areas that are prone to methane explosion. So the same structures that you analyze underground, they may be prone to seismicity, but those cracks that are probably caused by seismicity could also act as conduit for water and methane to the mining levels. We can use these technologies to save the miners underground. So that's why I really liked your story, because, you know, in terms of the sound, the singing, you know, and I'm like, actually, not just the voice, also we can use the sound waves to investigate the subsurface of the earth and save the miners.
Wow. But I mean, you not only said, you know, that Zulu singer, mine worker, didn't just save my grandfather's life.
Yeah.
He gave me a life, in as much as
exactly.
I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for that. So,
yeah.
And for me, in a sense, it's also given me that sense of, well, how do I use my privileges and my in such a way that I can also deal with South Africa's history? Now, have you written an algorithm that deals with the fault lines in human nature? And maybe talk a bit about your faith position, because I know you also to be a person who has found a transcendence in your situation, which is what Eusebius also noticed.
To be honest, I want to share with you something that's very, very touchy and very sensitive, but it's the reality. Mm. My sister passed away, so that was my pandemic. Mm. My sister was not staying with my nieces. Mm. When my sister was alive, my nieces still didn't have a parent because they were by themselves.
Really?
Because my sister didn't stay with my nieces. She left them with my mother to look after them. She disappeared. Mm. So that's what happened. So now let's look at the pandemic. So the pandemic is that my sister died and my mother died. When my sister was alive, I didn't take my nieces because they still had a mother. But it doesn't mean that if my sister did not die, my nieces will have gone to better schools. Mm. The death had somehow associated with a lot of positive. Mm. Because we have to bear in mind that if she had not died, I wouldn't have taken them to Johannesburg. I wouldn't have slept with them in the library because she would have still been alive. But it doesn't mean that they would have had opportunities. Mm. You know, like we're living in the pandemic now. So the question is, you know, what do we do? And for me, in my mind, I'm thinking there's two types of people. It's like there's people who are going to wait and do nothing and wait for what we call the post-COVID-19. But you don't really focus on your goals because your goals are beyond your control. Mm-hmm. You know, it's more like if you write an exam. You write an exam, but you don't grade yourself. Mm-hmm. So you have no control on whether you reach your goals or not. What is it that we can control? So that's where I think my belief system comes in terms of, Musa, take a step back. We're hitting a pandemic situation. What is it that you can do and not focus on the things that you cannot do. This is the government responsibility. This is my responsibility. So in this particular case, I say then, what are the things that we need to do for us to see that post-COVID-19 phase? What do we see beyond COVID-19? For me, it's like what you see determines what you, how you think today. And how you think today determines how you behave today. And how you behave today determines whether you'll see COVID-19 phase or not. We want to be free. But to be free, actually determined by how we behave today, you know. So that's why now when I look at that in my life, I focused on my character, on my behaviors. Those are the things that I could control. I focus on looking at and looking after my nieces every single day, washing them in a basin. Those are the things that I could do. In doing so, people identify potential and they invested in it. But what was my responsibility? My response to that help. And I think that's where the key is in my belief system, that we have to focus on the things that only us can do. Because if you focus on them, eventually you get to your goals. I can be locked in a room and drink so much that even when we go through this pandemic, when the time comes, then actually I'm not healthy because I was just waiting and drinking, waiting for this period to pass. So what I'm saying is, actually when you do that, you actually prepare to die when that free moment comes, when COVID-19 is over. What you do at the time during pandemic is very important in determining where you are when we've crossed over that road. Sometimes people ask me, what will I change about my life? And I always say, I will not change anything about my life because it has changed how I look at life. It has given me new lenses through which I look at life, through which I look at people. For example, when I came from Debt, KwaZulu-Natal, I used to think that, you know, Indians and white people were the same. So I basically hated white people. But when I got to Vet, who helped me? Was an Indian man. When I got to Vet, when I didn't have a place to stay, who helped me? There were people from outside Africa, outside South Africa and outside Africa who actually assisted me in raising my nieces. And when I had no place to stay, it was a white lady who took me in. So now, coming from KwaZulu-Natal, having the idea that Indian people, white people, like, are horrible. That's the picture I have because it's based on my experiences. Then the pandemic brings me into this life whereby now I'm forced, you know, to actually look at things in a very different way, in a new perspective, and then it brings new friends, relationships. And it has shaped, I mean, I'm getting married, my fiance is white. When I was 17 years, would I have thought of that? No, because I hated them. But you look at the opportunities, I've traveled the world, I've been in Germany, whatever, Spain and stuff. I interact with people from different colors. Not to say that there's no discrimination. It's how personally I view people that determines sometimes my relationship with them. Because if for a moment I meet them, I have an idea to say that, oh wow, I don't interact with these. How many doors do you close in your career? It doesn't matter, I get stopped by the police and they say, oh, do you have drugs? They always say, why do you laugh when we say that? And I'm like, I'm not going to fight with you. I'm not even going to say to you, you're stopping me because I'm black. Because I'm a scientist. I know you're stopping me because a lot of guys who do drugs, that they're black and they have dreadlocks. and they laugh about it like, you always smile when we stop you. I'm like, because I know the stats. And I cannot say they are not racist. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is just the way I approach them, the lenses I use to look at them when they approach me, changes the whole sphere, the whole conversation. For me, this is life. Because if we think about it, and when my pandemic happened, when my mother died, I could have committed suicide. But then looking at it now, actually, I could have died when my mother died and continued to exist. And that's what a pandemic does. I mean, I talk to a lot of people now, sometimes like 65 years old, and I chat to them like, what happened? They just don't enjoy what they're doing. they died the day their loved one died. Mm. And they continue to exist. Mm. So they're just waiting for the day of burial. Mm. But have they lived? No, they died on the day the pandemic arrives, and they continue to exist. Because when you exist, you don't live, you just exist. Mm. And then so they've got three dates: the day they were born, the day they died, and the day they were buried.
Say a bit more about what that, having made that choice and choosing life, how do you see your future unfolding? What expectations do you have?
So for me, my drive is the same. You know, again, the defining moment is when my mother passed away. I really love my mother, and I had a very close relationship with my mother. But when my mother died, and I survived the whole suicide thing, I said to myself, I didn't see a miracle happening with my mother, but I know that God has chosen me to be a miracle for so many young people who are going through what I went through. I'm a physicist, so I'll make an example. You know, Newton's law of motion says that an object remains on motion, it does not lose its speed unless acted upon by external factors. So which means that if you have your goals, you are focused, you have a big dream, don't let external variables deviate your focus. And this is what pandemic does, is that we tend to forget who we are because we're waiting for this moment, which may never come. And for me, the drive is right now, as I chat to you through online systems, I have to continue living my life to inspire, motivate the young people, because we may never reach that stage whereby we say maybe we're going to be able to talk face to face again. This is life itself. And I can make a very simple example. I woke up the other day and I said to my partner, I have a wedding planned for November because we want a big gathering. We had 250 people in the list. And I said, that is against my belief system. We're waiting for the life to happen. But this is life now. We're getting married next month. Because what if in November there is no gathering of 250 people? So this is what I'm trying to say now. This is life. So in the pandemic, there is so much that we can draw from it, you know. And for example, there are people losing jobs. But I was thinking to myself, there are people probably have been in the most horrible jobs that they were scared of leaving because they didn't know what to do. But this is actually forcing us to actually look for other opportunities. That's where innovation comes in. So we are pressed against the bedrock. And when we're in that state, we are able to actually be innovative and find other ways to survive. And that's what I'm looking at when I look at the pandemic, that there is so much to live for right now than just waiting for the moment that we actually never know whether it's going to come or not. When I look back right now, every time I wake up, I always get reminded, what if during my own pandemic, I had taken my own life? What if I had taken my own life? My nieces wouldn't have a career right now. South Africa would have been robbed of whatever its first black South African to obtain a PhD in geophysics. I can never continue to count the number of students I have graduated and supervised, the lives probably that have been saved because of who I am and my chat with them. So in that moment of pandemic, it was not only about myself and my family, but it was about South Africa as a whole. What if I had taken my life during my own pandemic? So many lives would have been lost. Life is hard, but I believe that there is a choice. When you're hit by the earthquake, how do you respond? And I think for me, the power was, as much as I was hit, my response, my reflection in that moment was very critical in terms of how I looked at life and also how people came into my life, different types of people to assist me and try to help me. It was also based on how I responded to the help. you know. And when I look at my nieces now, I gave them the name. I had to change their names, by the way. When I took them, because I wanted to define a new moment in our family, I changed their names to Joy and Hope. Mm. You see, when I looked at them at that age, when we were sleeping in the lab, I'm like, I see hope. Mm. And I remember I said to myself, if there is no hope for the future, there is no strength to live in the now. So I wanted to live in the now, hoping that we'll go through this pandemic. And here they are now, done very well. I've done very well for. We still go through challenges, but I still fail, but I don't give up. It's up to us to channel our energy into the positive and say, this is life itself, and we have to enjoy it.
Listening to Musa, and then listening again and again while editing, it occurred to me that besides being a tough-minded, tender-hearted, and steady-handed person, that Musa has another wonderful aspect of his character that he has worked on, a listening ear. An ear for listening to seismic waves and the earth below, an ear for the inner story of other people, and also an ear for music. And an extraordinary voice to share it with others.
Sing, Musa.
The timeless theme and heaven will pass. It's not a dream. God will make all things new. That day, gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternity.
There will be no-
Well, thanks for watching. Appearing now is a link to a playlist of this special series so that you can soak up the wisdom of other friends on how to deal with this pandemic. Also, there's a box appearing to subscribe to my channel so that you can get notice of the next one coming up soon. Meanwhile, please give me feedback in the comments section below, and thank you so much until next time.